Recorded Books and RB Digital present What You Really Need to Lead, The Power of Thinking and Acting Like an Owner, by Robert Steven Kaplan, narrated by L.J. Ganser. Introduction. Demystifying Leadership. What it really means, how it can be learned, and why ownership is essential. Leadership. It's one of the most important and frequently discussed subjects in our society. Consider these views on leadership from a selection of iconic historical figures and influential thinkers. A quote from Nelson Mandela. It is better to lead from behind and to put others in front, especially when you celebrate victory when nice things occur. You take the front line when there is danger. Then people will appreciate your leadership. A quote from Martin Luther King, Jr. A genuine leader is not a searcher for consensus, but a molder of consensus. A quote from John C. Maxwell. A leader is one who knows the way, goes the way, and shows the way. A quote from Lao Tzu. A leader is best when people barely know he exists. When his work is done, his aim fulfilled, they will say, "We did it ourselves." A quote from Peter Drucker. Management is doing things right. Leadership is doing the right things. What is your definition of leadership? How does this definition help you figure out what to do if you face a challenge in managing an individual, a team, or an entire company? See an issue in your community and wonder whether you should take steps to do something about it. Observe a colleague struggling with a particular task and consider whether you should offer to help. Notice a piece of trash on the floor at work and consider whether you should bend down and pick it up. What does it really mean to you to be a leader? Leadership touches every aspect of our lives. We regularly talk about the need for leadership in our communities, institutions, companies, and at all levels of government. We often lament a lack of leadership when things go wrong, and wish we had more of it when organizations seem to drift. When things go right, we are quick to attribute the good outcomes to effective leadership. Given all the various contexts in which we talk about leadership, the extensive scholarly work that has been done to explore its key elements, and the tremendous effort universities and companies have put into developing it, you would think we'd have a strong shared understanding of what it is. In my experience, we do not. Either you have it or you don't, right? These days, when I meet new people, I often tell them that I'm a professor at Harvard Business School. In response, people are typically complimentary, seem intrigued, and want to hear more. They usually follow up by asking me what I teach. Leadership, I answer proudly. This answer is typically met with a blank stare or a skeptical frown. I don't think you can teach that, or I'm not sure that can be learned, they say. They explain that, in their view, you're either a leader or you're not. I respond by trying to explain how leadership can be taught. I tell them that I believe leadership skills can be, and often have to be, learned. By and large, the people I speak with, many of whom are CEOs or aspiring executives, don't buy it. They argue that leadership is an innate quality or a state of being. Either you have it or you don't. They believe that there is an elite group of people who possess certain qualities and another less talented group who simply don't. As a consequence, they think that trying to teach leadership is likely to be a futile effort. This reaction used to really upset and frustrate me. Why couldn't I convince people that leadership is a capability that can be cultivated and learned? I have seen it done over and over again, including in my own executive experience. Can leadership be learned? Through several decades, scholars and practitioners have done an extensive amount of work to help people learn to be leaders. This work has delineated key elements of leadership, identified critical challenges that leaders face, and even suggested various approaches for how leadership qualities can be developed. Additionally, over the last 50 years, tens of thousands of students have attended classes at leading universities, or taken part in company-sponsored leadership development programs, all designed to cultivate and improve their leadership abilities. Despite this abundance of excellent thinking, training, and advice, many people continue to believe that leadership can't be learned. They often use expressions such as born leader or natural leader. These expressions implicitly equate natural personality traits, such as charisma or extroversion, with leadership skills. Based on my own experience, innate traits don't necessarily translate into effective leadership. And conversely, the lack of certain traits doesn't preclude someone from becoming a superb leader. For several years, I have tried to demystify leadership to make it more accessible to practitioners. I have taught classes, studied the writings of various leadership scholars and successful practitioners, led and worked on various business projects, and engaged with business and nonprofit leaders in an effort to help them improve their performance. During this time, I have written two books designed to help people develop their leadership capabilities, as well as to better understand themselves. My goal was to provide useful guides that could be put into practice and help people more effectively build their careers, run their organizations, and reach their unique potential. However, the more I have worked with executives and aspiring leaders, the more I have realized that a central reason why so many people struggle with the question of whether leadership can be learned, and whether they are themselves leaders, is that leadership means something different to each of us. Whether we're aware of it or not, each of us has a different conception of what leadership is and what a leader does. Our own individual conception, whatever its origins, can have a powerful impact on our actions. I have found that many talented people, including some of those who have used my previous books, are still hampered in their development because of their mindset and implicit assumptions regarding the nature of leadership. What does leadership really mean to you? Conceptions of leadership in our society are shaped in very specific ways. For example, many people get their frame of reference from those larger-than-life characters celebrated by popular culture, and especially by television and the movies. Think of John Wayne, iconic tough guy in his many film roles, commanding firefighters, green berets, and the cavalry. Somehow, we just know that Colonel Mike Kirby, Wayne's character in the green berets, didn't need to learn to lead. He had a charismatic personality and was blessed with great natural instincts, which helped him figure out what to do. In these films, we really don't get any insight into how he developed his abilities. We're left to assume that he must have been born with an acute sense of timing and an innate ability to understand and command people. Many people base their conceptions of leadership on their knowledge of prominent figures, past and present. For example, think of political leaders like Franklin Roosevelt, Ronald Reagan, Angela Merkel, or Winston Churchill. Or think of business pioneers like Sam Walton, Estee Lauder, or Steve Jobs. Alternatively, think of sports figures who led their teams to a championship. We tend to form some type of narrative regarding what made them great. They were captivating speakers, or highly innovative in a way that changed an industry, or brave under pressure and performed in the clutch. How they arrived there isn't completely clear to us. Our image of them is often frozen in time at the point of their greatest achievement. In addition to popular culture and prominent historical figures, our conceptions of leadership are shaped by people we know directly, teachers, family members, bosses, or prominent local leaders in our communities. The styles of these leaders can vary enormously. They might be distinctive personalities, confident and charismatic. They may seem to possess special qualities that help them have an impact on people and shape events. These special qualities may seem to be developed and built on innate gifts, in the same way someone has athletic ability or musical talent. Watching them may lead us to think that either people have these gifts or they don't. If the leaders we admire are really successful, they might be celebrated on the covers of important magazines or in headlines on the web. If and when things subsequently go wrong, sometimes only a short time later, These same leaders are often vilified just as enthusiastically as they were praised. When that happens, people who used them as their role models feel disillusioned and are forced to rethink their conceptions of leadership. What's your definition of leadership? A few years ago, I started asking senior executives to write down their definitions of leadership. I have learned a lot from the responses. The definitions varied widely. Some would say that a leader inspires and mobilizes others to advance a shared purpose or accomplish a specific set of strategic objectives. Some respondents say that leaders have a knack for thinking about the future and being in the forefront of some trend or movement, a cause, a new way of thinking, or an innovative approach to solving a problem, and then convincing and rallying others to go along with them. They cite intellectual curiosity, vision, positive energy, charisma, and communication skills as critical elements of leadership. Still others say that getting people to follow your lead is an outdated notion, and that today leadership is more about empowering and serving others. They believe that a leader creates the conditions and environment that enable people to be innovative and take action. I agree with elements of each of these definitions, and yet each seems incomplete. Then there are the more practical and savvy executives who have a very different conception of leadership. They think all this touchy-feely, qualitative stuff is basically irrelevant. They argue that scholarly studies of leadership are interesting, but for the most part, don't ultimately matter very much. Their analysis goes more or less as follows. Just tell me one thing. Is the leader running a business that is making money? If the business is making money, then the person running it must be a good leader. If the business isn't making money, then the person running it probably isn't a good leader. That's leadership. Results. By this definition, leaders and leadership practices can come and go, depending on the fortunes of their firms and their industries. Based on this idea of leadership, they believe that first and foremost, leaders should spend their time worrying about revenues and profits. The qualitative stuff might help, but there's no substitute for generating good commercial results. This conception may strike you as unduly narrow because of its single-minded focus on results. You may even think that it is an exaggeration of a particular point of view. However, the reality is that many of us consciously or subconsciously evaluate leaders exactly this way, by results. Leaders look a whole lot smarter and more competent when things go well. Did you win re-election? Then you must be an effective government official. Does your team have a winning record? Then you must be a good coach. Did you accomplish the military mission? If yes, then you must be a strong commander. Is your company making a lot of money this year? Then you must be a skilled executive. The problem with the single-minded results orientation is that it can be heavily affected by factors that are outside the control of the executive. In other words, it helps to pick the right industry, benefit from a strong economy, and maybe have a little luck. These external factors may distract a leader from proactively focusing on those practices and issues that are under their control, and would help them build a more sustainable enterprise. The history of business is replete with stories about executives who were celebrated as superb leaders, only to be cast aside as abject failures when their businesses began to lose money, or even failed. How could a person go from being a great leader to a bum within a few short years, or even a matter of months? Is leadership that fleeting or fragile? That's a scary thought. If it's true, why would anyone step up to a challenging leadership situation in which the odds of success appear to be low? In search of a shared understanding. After several years of these discussions, I finally had an unsettling epiphany. We really don't have a widely shared understanding of what leadership is. But how could that be? There's a whole industry, of which I'm a part, that focuses on leadership, and, in my opinion, has collectively done superb work in unpacking the key elements of leadership. In Appendix B of this book, I include a detailed list of important and influential writings on leadership, authored by selected academics and practitioners. Companies have drawn extensively on this body of work, investing heavily in training, teaching, and career development processes to build leaders in their organizations. In my own executive career, I have benefited greatly from reading much of this work, which emanated both from academia and from the executive suite. Yet, despite all this, there still seems to be confusion about the subject of leadership. Does this confusion matter? Yes, because if you're confused about what a leader is supposed to do, it's probably going to be harder to figure out what you should do when you get into a leadership situation. The issue. I have come to believe that when all is said and done, we are often better at teaching leadership best practices than we are at addressing and resolving the various conflicting conceptions of leadership. A person's conception of leadership matters because it will likely have a strong influence on how he or she processes the writings, leadership coaching, and development practices he or she experiences. We may have underestimated the enormous power of various conflicting conceptions. That power can work against us, in that it undermines our ability to get to a widely shared understanding of leadership. This lack of shared understanding is a big problem for all of us. We often talk about the need for more and better leadership in the world. Many of the ills of our society are explained by a lack of leadership. Most of us want to be effective leaders. Most CEOs say that the biggest thing their organization lacks is leadership. But what exactly do we want more of? Very often we can't precisely say, or we disagree on what we want, but we can all agree that we want more of it. If we can't agree on a clear definition of leadership, how do we decide whom to hire and promote? How do we recognize a leader when we see one? For example, how can we tell whether a candidate running for office will be an effective leader? More importantly, what exactly are we supposed to do when we get into a leadership position? To answer this, we usually fall back to our own preconceptions, or what we've seen previous bosses do, or how our current boss behaves. We may even solicit advice from others inside or outside our organizations. Very often, though, this advice is contradictory, because advisors we consult have their own unique ideas regarding what a leader does. As a result, we may flounder and improvise. What would my boss want me to do? We might revert back to company practices, or what we've done in the past that worked, or maybe look to what others are doing in a similar situation. When we're presented with a situation we haven't seen before, we may just go with our instincts. This isn't necessarily a bad approach, unless you're part of a team or a company where individual members each take their own path in a given situation, which can result in disorganization or even chaos. Wouldn't it be helpful if we had a better shared understanding of the key elements of what a leader does and how that applies to us individually, in our current jobs, and in our daily lives? Is there a framing that would help organize all the great advice and best practices that seem to help individuals and organizations be more effective? With this enhanced understanding, we could take actions that would fit our industry, our company, and our own individual characteristics. Creating a leadership frame. It starts with an ownership mindset. I have spent the past several years trying to demystify and define leadership. Building on my own experience, as well as the work of numerous scholars and practitioners, I have tried to break leadership down into terms that are accessible and understandable. My purpose is to help people take actions that fit who they are and further their unique aspirations and those of their organizations. In this book, I will offer a framing for your leadership journey. I will make the argument that leadership starts with an ownership mindset. That is, do you think as if you are in the shoes of a decision maker and act in a manner that takes ownership of the consequences of your actions? Do you focus on adding value to others? Do you take responsibility for the impact of your actions on others, both positive and negative? Do you take responsibility for continually learning to become a leader and learning to understand yourself? As you will see throughout this book, the concepts of leadership and ownership are tightly intertwined. Once you have developed an ownership mindset and are willing to take responsibility for learning to be a leader, you will improve your effectiveness by empowering others to act in the same way. This book will discuss techniques for engaging others in a way that helps you dramatically improve your leadership. It will also suggest actions you can take that will help get you started on the road to becoming a better leader. I hope that this framing will help you create a clearer mindset for your activities, provide tools and techniques that you can use today, and help you realize that you can be a leader. My purpose is to discourage your inclination to wait to be a leader someday or leave leadership to someone else. My goal is to convince you that you can and should strive to think like an owner and be a leader today, now, as well as tomorrow and into the future. This book comprises 5 chapters. Chapter 1, The Ownership Mindset. What does it mean to be a leader? What does it mean to have an ownership mindset? In this chapter, I will explore the critical elements of leadership and pose several key questions you must ask in your quest to become a leader. Some of these questions deal with intellectual issues, while others address emotional issues. Exploring these questions will likely confirm some of your existing instincts about leadership and cause you to rethink some of your assumptions. It may reinforce some of your theories that grow out of past experiences. It should help you make your instincts and theories much more actionable. At the same time, you will likely find that you've been a leader more often than you thought, but that you've also failed to act like a leader in certain critical situations, which may explain some of your current regrets. We don't often get do-overs in the real world, but learning from the past and considering what you could have done differently can be a highly productive exercise for adapting your behavior and shaping your future. This chapter should help you realize that you have it within your power today to make a significant difference in your company, family, and community. Leadership isn't reserved for presidents, generals, and CEOs, the big shots. You don't need a written invitation to be a leader. It is a mindset and way of behaving that begins today. Chapter 2, Tackling the Challenges of Leadership. If your reaction to the discussion in Chapter 1 is, well, what's so hard about that? This chapter provides a good antidote. Being a leader is often challenging, and frequently people fail because they haven't developed the capacity to play that role, particularly as the role evolves. Being open to learning, resisting the dangers of isolation, and accepting some level of vulnerability are critical elements of sustainable leadership. Many people aren't yet in shape to perform the actions that will help them to assert themselves and make an impact. Or they have been successful for a period of time, but then something changes, and they don't have the capacity to adapt to the new situation. In this chapter, we will explore several of the reasons why people so often fail to lead or ultimately lose their way, and we will look at some of the tools you can use to combat these challenges. First among these tools is your ability to be confident enough to ask questions and listen to others. You'll see that leadership is less frequently about ability or power or even resources. Far more often, it is about your mindset and your ability to adequately understand your situation and yourself. Interestingly, leadership failure can occur even though those around you see you, the situation, and what needs to be done remarkably clearly, even as you are blind to it. In this chapter, we'll discuss the pitfalls of leadership and actions you can take to address your blind spots, recognize transitions more clearly, and make failure far less likely. Chapter 3, Mastering the Essential Processes of Leadership. This chapter sets forth a regimen of steps for learning to improve your leadership skills. Embedded in this book's conceptual framing of leadership is a detailed set of processes and habits that you will need to master in order to build your capacity to lead and then sustain that leadership. The first process is intellectual, articulating a clear vision, setting priorities, and creating alignment with your vision and priorities. The second process is far more amorphous and complex. It focuses on understanding yourself. Although you may not be consciously aware of it, you are executing, or failing to execute, these processes every single day. It takes hard work and continuous attention to master these processes. Leadership is not a state of being or a destination where you finally arrive and can then relax. On the contrary, it is a journey that requires consistent diligence, focus, and attention. I believe these processes are very much analogous to getting in shape or losing weight. Just like these processes, if you let your efforts slide, your ability to exhibit leadership behaviors is very likely to atrophy. This chapter will explore vision, priorities, and alignment processes, as well as your effort to better understand yourself. You may find that some of these activities are easier for you than others. Additionally, these efforts can be particularly challenging because they are taking place in parallel. Lack of attention to one of these processes may make it harder to accomplish the other. This chapter will lay out a series of very specific questions you need to ask to continually develop your capacities for leadership. Chapter 4. You can't do this alone. Leadership is a team sport. That is to say, your success is inextricably linked to the activities and contributions of others. You are highly unlikely to become a leader or develop your leadership capabilities all by yourself. Almost certainly, the steps described in this book will be far more difficult to master if you don't improve your ability to cultivate relationships and work effectively with others. Do you have relationships based on mutual understanding, trust, and respect? Are you able to reveal information about yourself in relationships? Do you have friends or colleagues who will tell you things you may not want to hear, but need to hear? In this chapter, I will discuss the importance of relationships in leadership development. I will also suggest a number of steps you can take to cultivate effective relationships and describe techniques for improving your ability to build more effective bonds with others. If you can begin to master this skill, you will find that everything else in this book will be much easier to accomplish. Chapter 5. The Ownership Path as a Lifelong Journey. If you are beginning to believe that following the steps in this book will help you to pursue a more fulfilling path in your life, what do you want to do about it? What tools and techniques can you use that will help you jumpstart your efforts? How might you want to try these tools? Where do you start? This chapter is intended to get you moving down the path. It will help you start the journey from where you are today. It begins with helping you explore what you truly care about. What would give more meaning to your life? What are your skills and passions? What is your own definition of success? Are you living your own dream or someone else's? What actions do you want to take to reach your unique potential? The world is full of challenges and opportunities. This chapter will outline several ideas for how to think about your next moves and offer various alternatives for making the most of your abilities. It will discuss intrinsic versus extrinsic motivators and ways to get a better grip on how they apply to you. This chapter will help stimulate your thinking about how you might put your toe or foot or entire leg in the water. The key elements of the preceding 5 chapters are summarized in Appendix A, Essentials of What You Really Need to Lead. This visual guide should prove useful as a framework.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.